Quiet on notch on there. T'a holier ishlane. Nash aho. T'a het ensen there. T'a totlish. Nijunigo. Nitsrago. A yo shilliat ehun seno. Ado. Cheshe shilholne. Ede edo t'a het eda. Doshilhut eda. Hongwano nasisa. T'a adon sich adala. Besen nahesti a ze, sisad na long. Oh, besen na. Shiene, itcha.
My name's Melanie Yazzie, and I'm Diné, and I currently am the head of printmaking here at the University of Colorado Boulder. I come from northeastern Arizona. As I grew up, I always loved making art, and my mother was an artist in college. She made jewelry, she did drawings and paintings, and it was something really important to her. But both my parents chose to go into education. My parents were teaching many farm school area, and there was a Montessori school. I was enrolled in a class there, and I remember that was the first time I made a small painting.
That day she came back that evening and she said, "Look what I made." And then we said, "Wow, look, it looks elephant. Even this tail is showing, and the ears and the trunk." And we were so proud of her. And then she said, "Mom, you can have it." So ever since then, I kept it and reframed it. And I think it's been framed several times with the wear and tear on it. Every day since then, I want to do art.
I think that time period really marks something in me of like what it meant to be an artist.
We knew that she was going to be an artist because she always did something with watercolors and finger painting stuff, all those artwork that she does. The only thing we said to her was very expensive to be an artist, but she didn't hear us, she just kept going.
My sophomore year in high school, I went to Westtown School on the East Coast, about 40 minutes out of Philadelphia. And it was there, my senior year, I allowed myself to take an art class. In that art class, I started making prints and learning about printmaking. I really wanted to go to art school. I was working a job on the reservation and I earned some money to buy a plane ticket to go to Mexico. And at the same time, my parents were enrolling me at Arizona State University, and we had paid tuition, found me an apartment, gone through that whole process. And like 2 weeks before school started, I said to my parents when we were buying books, I said, "We have to return these books. We have to, like, I can't do this." And they were just like, "What?" And I said, I bought a plane ticket to Mexico. I'm gonna go live in Mexico this year, and I can't do this." And my parents were furious, and they didn't understand it, but it was really important for me to do that. And I think during that year, I really learned the importance of education, the importance of following things that are important to you as an artist, also the importance of identity.
I think that's all you can do is just encourage your daughters or son that wants to go into whatever they want to go, is just encourage them. I think that's what we did. And even though we didn't have a lot of monies, we always went and bought things that they would really need. But she was on honors where she went to school with a scholarship, so we didn't have to worry to pay for her. And she went through all that school year being an honor student.
I was teaching one semester, one seminar, one semester a year at CU in Boulder, and Melanie was a graduate student. So she was, she was Melanie. I mean, and she was so great. One of the wonderful things I loved about her is, a lot of the students were Anglo or non-native, and they were, kind of intrigued with what native people thought and so on. And whenever anybody, was sort of putting natives down, Melanie was always very clear about, don't do that, and here's all the good stuff and so on. But if somebody idealized them or idealized natives, she would come up with some story about some relative of hers who was a mess. I mean, so she always had a wonderful balance between that. She didn't play to Anglo's expectations at all.
I never thought I'd be teaching in a university setting. I strangely assumed that if I went into the arts that I would just be living with my parents and making art in their garage. And when I had that in my mind, I thought, I'm going to be out on the reservation. I won't have any access to all these chemicals or all of this fancy stuff. So I focused on low-tech printing methods.
I feel like I've learned so much from Melanie in so many different ways because we've been friends now for so long. I've seen her professional career develop. I've learned a lot about the way she moves through the world and how she can connect with people in a really positive way. She's sharing deep and meaningful things, but one of the main lessons I think she's sort of taught me is when you have something important to say that might be heavy or unpleasant, if you just come out and say it in a too harsh of a way or too direct of a way, people tend to shut down and not hear your message. But if you approach something with compassion and humor and a more palatable approach, people are more receptive to your message.
Something that I've learned from Melanie is to have what I would call like a spirit of giving. Like, I've always been really impressed with her kindness and her willingness to share her artwork. Like, she will just like give you an art piece and say, here, this is for you. And that's made me, I think about that more often and be more kind and open and generous with my own artwork to share that with a lot of other people.
I was finishing my undergrad at the University of Arizona, and I ran a nonprofit art gallery, and many people in the university sphere of art and also just local Tucson artists were involved in this alternative art gallery, and Melanie's students in particular were involved in having shows at the Shane House. So it was about 2004. We both were smitten at about the same time. It was pretty fast. We got married within a year.
It was really nice because I've been married twice before, and I thought, you know, maybe I just shouldn't be in this whole thing called marriage. And we met, we became good friends, and one thing led to another, and it was wonderful.
As a gallery, normally artists will just bring their work in and we would sell it and that's it. But with Melanie, we have more of a collaborative relationship. Melanie and I have collaborated on the jewelry and the scarves and the fabrics and promotion, really, and sculpture, and kind of bringing her vision to life. So we've learned a lot from each other about how she communicates, how we present things and want to show her work in the best light and put her on an international stage, because she really is an international artist. She's Navajo, and that's super important to her, and it's an amazing culture, and it's informed so much of her work. But as she's said, there are certain things she can't portray because that would be sort of against her teachings with her grandmother, saying, you know, you can insinuate things, you can imply things with your art, but don't be too direct about anything that's culturally sensitive. So she imbues so many things with all of these concepts that may not appear to have that depth, but when you start talking to her or you really start sitting with something and looking at the prints, and they're layered. So everything to me in her artwork is layered in technique, it's layered in substance, it's layered in messaging, so there's a whole lot going on there. And she's been so supportive of us, it's just been incredible. She's such a genuine, amazing person and really cares about us as a gallery, but us as people. So it just is a different level.
I think what I want people to come away from with the artwork is a story, something that they didn't expect. I think there's a lot of preconceptions about my work when people first see it. And then when they meet me and hear the story about the piece, they start to see how many different things connect with each other. And they're like, wow, you know, it's more than just this thing we thought it was. And I learned all these other things about who you are and where you're coming from just from hearing your talk or doing a print project. Because oftentimes when I'm doing an exhibition, I'll do an interaction thing where either I do a lecture, I'll do a print workshop or an art workshop with the community, and then people come to that and learn something. They'll learn how to make some of the things I do, and then they come away thinking, oh my God, it's really not that easy, and it's really hard. And I started to be able to tell my story, and I'm like, yes, everybody has a story. And that's what this is about, is to empower people to find their own story, to make their own story. And I think if everybody was allowed to tell their own story, there wouldn't be so many angry people that feel left out or feel that they can judge other people, because everybody's sharing story and comes together, and there's a meeting at that place when people can share a story. So my hope is that when people see the work and hear the stories, that there's a connection that's made, an understanding about who I am, who my community is, and for that matter, who they are, gives them permission to look at themselves.
It has meaning to her. So she usually talks about it the way she feels about it. But I always told her that, well, the Indian people always, you know, draw different things, like real things. But she was, this is my art, she says. I learned that every individual have their own art, the way they do it, the way they think about it, the way they feel about it.
The ceramic pieces that I make were inspired by childhood bullies. Because my dad was a principal and my mom was a teacher, recess was really scary because, you know, some of the kids who would get in trouble would come looking for us at recess. And so I started naming these animals after, like, common Navajo names. I didn't really ever use the same name as bullies, but it was a way to sort of empower myself and to reclaim that memory and put it into a good light. So the names of the sculptures are pretty funny, like Joe Baker's looking for a rich girlfriend, or Thelma Joe thinks she's cool, she lives in Gallup. They just have funny names that take common Navajo names and then common things that we know at home to put the title together. And the prints that I make are inspired by plants, weavings. There is also drawings of petroglyphs from different locations. So I'll have a series of petroglyphs in the artwork that I make, and then I'll print a matte form on top of the petroglyph images. And again, each thing is about land, placement of who we are as Indigenous people, and what's important to us. A lot of the works that I have riverways and byways, and that refers to the digestive tract, but also highways and rivers, places that I've traveled to.
I think a lot of people communicate in different ways. Some people choose to communicate visually through artwork. And so I think having something to say, knowing how to say that through your artwork, and having a voice that can touch people and can create some kind of response in people, I think is important for being an artist.
The motivation for my work most recently has been educating people about what it's like to live as a type 2 diabetic. The work has the numbers in them, and it helps me have a conversation with people who have a family member who's living with diabetes, somebody who is a diabetic, somebody who's a caretaker for somebody. There's a whole conversation in the numbers that happens that I feel is really important. And when I travel to different places, it seems to be a common illness within Indigenous communities and also in the wider community. And so it helps me connect with people. I think what was happening a lot of the time is that I'm living with this illness and those numbers control my life. And so for the longest time, I'd just be making work and kind of keep it hidden. And then I realized that part of becoming strong with it and learning how to live with it was to be able to put it into the work and be able to share it with people. And it's been very successful, because once I tell people and they start looking at the numbers, people who have diabetes will look at it and say, this is a really good day. or, oh my gosh, what happened? What did, you know, this is 192 or 142, your numbers are high, but here, what's that mean? And then we have this conversation about how a day may have started or how something stressful happened, and then I checked my blood sugar and it was higher. So it's a whole different language that happens within my work in relationship to people who know or are learning about being type 2 diabetic. And what's also always present in the work is the animal imagery. I love animals. I'm really close to them. And I feel that putting them into the work and sharing them with people brings out a whole nother story about how we live with animals and how animals can take a huge amount of stress off of you as a person.
She has so much to say, and she's been all over the world. My dad always laughs anytime he answers the phone and it's Melanie. Okay, what airport are you in? And she's usually somewhere far away doing some awesome adventure, interacting with native artists, indigenous artists around the world, or being asked to speak or teach in France or Japan or somewhere exotic and awesome.
When I go back to thinking about, you know, growing up on the res and doing what we did, that it grounds me in each place I go. The artwork ties into meeting artists and connecting with people on so many different levels. And I've traveled to Russia, to Siberia, to Japan, to Korea. I've taught in France. I've done projects in Germany. I've traveled to many places, and it's all because of the artwork and the connecting with people, indigenous and non-indigenous, because through family history and stories we meet, and then locations we have in common, we then form this relationship that's like very family-like and very much about heart and soul.
A true artist in my mind is someone who's compelled and is almost compulsive about needing to express themselves either visually or through music or filmmaking or whatever. There's a drive in true artists. They have something to say. They have something to share. They have something that's innovative.
From her, I've learned just having an attitude of like hard work, really putting a lot of time into art making and just constantly making art. Like, she is making art all the time. And so I think from her, I've learned just whether I'm successful or not successful doesn't matter, just to continually always be making art.
A true art, I think, is what they feel and what they want to put on paper, what they want to put in ceramics, what they want to put in their art pieces. It's kind of like a memory of something that they happened to them.
I have to create a beautiful world in my art. If I made work about all the bad things that happened, like, to carry that sadness and that history is very difficult. And so I make beautiful works to carry myself into a beautiful way of thinking and being, because that's important. So again, I acknowledge the bad that is in the world. And in my work, I'm trying to create a beautiful place, a place of calm, and a place that I can grow and become stronger to teach my students and to work in the communities that I'm working in. When I say that I'm a contemporary Native artist, in my mind, I'm thinking that I'm Navajo, I'm telling my story, and I'm not using all the images that people would think that I should be using. I'm finding my own path and my own symbols that represent all the things that are traditional or are from home.
My name is Melanie Yazzie, and I am of the Saltwater Clan, born for the Bitterwater Clan. My maternal grandfather's clan is Edgewater. My paternal grandfather's clan is Red Streak Into the Water. In this way, I am a beautiful Diné woman. Ahiha.